would like to say a few words in my welcome address. This event, we are the co-host with the FORE School. And let me introduce Dr. Jitin Das. He doesn't need any introduction, as a matter of fact. But since protocol and all that, blah, blah, so many things are involved, so it becomes paramount for me to introduce him. Dr. Das, I knew him a couple of years back, long, long back, when he was just, remembered his face. And in Lucknow, I had a very quick, short meeting with him. He forgot it, but fortunately, I remembered it. Okay. Dr. Das was associated with, I am Lucknow and Ahmedabad also. He used to go. And he was also a professor at the new business school, Austria also. Well-renowned personality, Dr. Das, with 37 years academic experience, academic plus administration both, academic administration both. And he is a known personality in government circles also. He has been member of various committees, institutions, government bodies, private and government both. And along with that, he did his doctorate. He is an IIT Delhi product. So our own Munda, I call it in Punjabi, our own Delhiites, because Delhiites feel proud of it. Whenever our own people from Delhi, they come and cross so many hurdles, just like a hurdle race. It is a mad race, and after crossing many hurdles. So here is Dr. Jitendra Das before all of you. Please give him a good hand. The students from FORE School, okay, and some volunteers from FWA also. So all of you are welcome here. So I hand over my things again at this mantle to Dr. Jitendra.
Because you are all our guests this morning, and we are very happy to have this roundtable with us this morning. Jointly with FWA. This is actually a very chance event. We did another conference with them, and while we were discussing, we wrote this idea of having such a closed door, small, a very specific interest group meetings on some or the other management theme. And so this is the first of such events. Maybe we'll be planning and doing more in the future. Now let's get on with our event. And my role now, from now until end, would be to moderate the sessions. So since this is a round table conference, a meeting, so everyone has equal opportunity and space to speak. We have no specific format. There are different ways that we can do this. My only request is that since our theme is impact of social media on the values of future generation, so we can keep ourselves focused on this.
Right.
At best, digress to internet. Okay, don't go beyond that, because internet is closely linked with social media. We can digress to that extent. And any example that you come across, any philosophical thoughts you have, any theories you have, any hypotheses you have, you share here so that we become more aware. And what we are doing internally here, that we have three students who have been aligned as rapport here. So they will be noting down these things in freehand, and we will generate a report, and maybe we will share it with you later on. And we also invited a few of our students to sit here and listen. At least, by listening, and you see the learned speakers sharing their views, you can pick up new things. Nonetheless, because the theme is the future generation, the students are the future generation. So if you all permit, as things go, we may invite them to share their views as to what is the social media. Because now we don't want to be in a situation where the millionaires sit together to reach how to remove poverty in the country in a 5-star hotel. So at least try to be as relevant as possible. So you all students here can put your thinking cap on. So we may be asking you for any new points on this, so that we useful. So one model is that everybody speaks for a few minutes and then we make it open. The other model is that from now I throw it open. Anybody who wants to speak first speaks and others respond. And my job would be to control if it leads to any cacophony or any uncontrolled debate discussions. That will be my job to control it. So please don't mind if I were to ask you to please be quiet for a while. So please don't mind that. There is nothing personal here.
This right.
Yeah, no, I'll do that. I'll do that. My request is that you please do not mind that, because that's my job. And there's nothing personal here. When I say please keep quiet, so don't take it personal. This is like pure official. And end of the event, you may unwind and do anything. But here, please follow that. So our only rule here would be you will speak, you respond, free format, no sequencing. And if there is a issue here in terms of ability to speak and contribute, then I'll pitch in and then I'll try to control it. Right? But since I am the moderator, I have the privilege of saying a few words in the beginning on this theme, because this theme is really very important, purely from the business perspective, at the very least for us, because we are a business school. So we have had these social media things in our curriculum, particularly in the marketing subject. We do talk of the impact of social media. Because as things have evolved from pure internet era of 1995 to a current situation where the phones, smartphones have all those internet-based applications and the technologies available, and free flow of information and communication happening across, so they become a powerful tool for marketing organizations to reach out to people. So this is formally we look at it. Because there's a lot of content here, I'll try to stay away from that. Because when we do a formal thing, we have numbers there. We talk of, like for example, viral marketing. So viral marketing is actually a number game. So it's actually a mathematical model. And it's like geometric progression. So you do it, and then this is what will happen. The marketing issue is like, how do you do that? The initial point. That's all. And that's how we discuss. So I'll try to be away from those domains. But social media has been really very crucial. Of late, we have had these concerns being raised. Only today, there is a news in the headlines, the newspapers today, where I think a High Court or a Supreme Court is saying that the CEOs of these social media companies are to be charged with criminal offense if a fake news leads to a crime. Now, this is what they're saying, but I don't know how this would be controlled ultimately. The simile which I draw from this is like, I'm a car manufacturer, I sell cars, you buy cars, and then the government tells me, the manufacturer of car, that if any criminal travels in the car, or if the guy engages in accident, things like that, you will be held responsible. Manufacturer of the car will be held responsible. And how can you do this? So since you don't have the capacity to control those criminals, so you want to charge the messenger, shoot the messenger. The one who's created the technology, you want to penalize that guy, because you have no way to control how the usage of that is leading to a problem. So I've developed a product. Product has good use and the bad use. So good use is okay. If there is a bad use, then you penalize the one who's developed. This is, to me, sounds a bit ridiculous, to say the least, but that's how it is. So social media has also been in the news because of various, the one which takes our time in the public domain when you read things is the politics in India and across the world. So politics has taken a whole lot of flack and things of that kind because of the social media. And one which has brought the social media and Facebook to a limelight in a negative sense was the charge that the Facebook is stealing data, the personal data, and developing specific messages for specific people to change the view of the individual, you know, right up to the individual level, which is the the Cambridge Analytica outfit who was doing a consulting for many companies, and they had access to Facebook. They had some agreement and they collected data, and then that's how things are happening. So more will come as we discuss this. So there are those kinds of issues. The students and the people like us spending hours a day on social media, and we are all familiar with WhatsApp, and people so engaged in WhatsApp that they are watching WhatsApp while they are walking. They are watching WhatsApp while they are driving, and the ensuing accidents and those tragedies that may happen, including for students who are spending time on social media, the impact of time spent on social media and the grades. There are technical study published, referee journal publications on this aspect. The time you spend on social media and how does it impact the grade. Now, grade impact for different kinds of students. So some kinds of study on this. So a lot of things have been done. So we may want to throw our views on this and hopefully try to crystallize things for us as a learning. So as an end objective, at the end of the day, what I have in mind is that we should be able to figure out that this is how the future generation will be impacted, positively or negatively. If it is positive, it's okay, perfect. If it is negative, at least we should identify the negative aspect. And if we can come up with a solution, like for example, you say use of social media means poor grades. So that's a problem, that's an issue, so we identify. And the solution, if you say, therefore they should not use social media, then there could be different views on it. So we may have some discussion on this, and then we'll see how it goes. So with this understanding, and please bear with me if I ask you to speak less, speak, not or something like that. So bear with me.
And there should not be repetitions.
Obviously, it is expected no repetitions, and then the moderator has a role to play.
Yes.
Hopefully, moderator will do a reasonably good job.
Future generation. But here I will add one or two more words. Future generation of teachers or faculty members, because we can't always assume that we are talking about the students. We should also talk about the parents as well as faculty members, because they are also coming with information. There is no generalization, no direction, no filtration. Everything, you have been bombarded with, you are loaded with the information. What to do when social media, you are surrounded with social media in your daily life, so mobile phone, internet, WhatsApp, Facebook. And you can see even children, even at the age of who are sixth grade students, I can see based on my personal example from my own child, who is right now 12-year-old boy and is studying in class. And recently I faced one major situation in his school, that what happened, that I have become director at IMS Garibar sometime back, and he comes to me that my father has become director. So somewhere he has shared this information that he has become director with his friend. Then some of his friend have become jealous, what he said, the way he said, I don't know. And these guys are using Instagram and an account on the name of my son, Arab Jain. And from, on the name of my son, 10th class, they came and grabbed his neck. Can you believe this? And this happened just one day before. And luckily I am in this seminar, so I was thinking this is a really, really an alarming situation. And psychology and sociology has been my passion. Long back I studied a theory called Theory of Cultural Lag by Ogburn and Nemkov. They talk about two kinds of culture, materialistic and non-materialistic culture. Non-materialistic culture are your values, beliefs and practices. Right now what is happening, that our physical growth is relatively slower than our psychological growth. And the kind of speed with which our children are growing is, I think, then we should distinguish between relevant or irrelevant, useful, not useful, desirable, not desirable. If they receive some undesirable information, then what to do with that? So somewhere we need to very, very careful about our new generation. And then values has changed drastically. I wrote two research papers published in Journal of Managerial Psychology and other Emerald Journal. And what I observed that egoistic motives, something called egoistic motive, the impact of egoistic motive on effective commitment, OCB, that is a typical research paper. And I found that the role of egoistic motive, like career growth, ambition, motive, like promotion, salary, money, has increased in quantum, uncontrollably. So the new generation is more driven by egoistic motive rather than altruistic motive. And now effective commitment and citizenship behavior comes from egoistic motive rather than altruistic motive. So the role of altruistic motive in our society is now undergoing. So I think the values have changed. Thank you very much.
Yeah, well, just one point linked to this. We have been saying this, but say that the amount of information that a normal urban human being in a city like Delhi absorbs in one day is the same set of information that a very active human being in the year 1 BC acquired in the entire lifetime. So that's the kind of information that our brain is processing. Now this statement came before the social media. So now with the social media on and people are spending so much of time on the social media, it's like, you know, psychologists are now deeply looking into this, the impact on the social media or the information on the behavior of people. But the point that was raised by Professor Jain is perfectly, absolutely valid to be noted. But then there is a other side to it also. This is the psychological aspect of it, but there is a formal learning aspect of it. Like for example, WhatsApp is being used in offices for better communication. WhatsApp is being something used by the teachers. Some have not liked it, but then they do it, so you can't stop it. We have Moodle and Claroline learning systems for student coordination and everything. But some faculty find it more convenient to use WhatsApp to do it. And then if it serves the purpose, then that's okay. Because objective is not Moodle, objective is learning environment. So if the WhatsApp is able to deliver, so we do have those aspects also, which contributes to the well-being of the society at large.
Right.
Can I
happen to write something. It's an enabler if you manage it. You become an enslaver, or you become a slave to it if you become a victim to it. Unfortunately, the younger generation is largely becoming a victim to it. Now, there are three terms interesting. One, they say is no more. No mobile phone creates a phobia.
Fear of, you know, what a
mobile phone. The other term is FOMO, fear of missing out. Will I miss out something if I don't have the mobile phone? And the third thing is fear of being on offline, FOBO, fear of being offline. Now all these three things, the younger generation, more so because of the competitive nature of the lifestyles that we lead, has made them slaves to the technology. And like Professor Jain rightly said, psychologically it's impacting them. And personal interactions are at a huge premium. Today there is no personal interaction. People are just communicating on technology. But is that good? I don't think so. Because nothing is more effective than personally talking to each other. So it's a huge worry. Just one more point. You must have heard the name Dr. Vivek Murthy, Surgeon General to Barack Obama. Now he's done extensive research and he says rather than physical ailments, the main problem with youngsters today largely is loneliness. Why loneliness? Because lack of personal interaction. So these are huge areas of concern. But how do we do it? I think we can manage it if you regulate it. We need to regulate it. The time that we spend on television included. Now if we start seeing the television in meetings, most of us do, we shouldn't do that. Or when we speak continuously, or what's the urge to be on the way. It can be a great benefit, as Professor Das said. Yes, but then if you continuously are a victim, anything in excess is bad. So we need to manage it smartly because it's a great advantage. We speedily communicate, we speedily transact. But if you overdo it, it's going to psychologically affect us, and we are seeing the strain of it in terms of physical assault, in terms of inadequacy, etc.
Thank you.
So may I, I'm Priya Bori, I'm also, is that when actually communication is not there, this is an indirect way of communicating with the outside world. So the younger generation that's sitting here today is actually, has more peer pressure than any of the generations gone by. So they have to look in a particular manner, they have to behave in a particular manner. And I think this is coming from all the, I would actually say the cheap American, value system, the middle class value system, because the high class has it there. Unfortunately, what is happening is that the parents are very busy. So what has happened is that the children are in isolation. Children are growing up. When we're talking about competitiveness, we are basically talking again about peer pressure. That you have to do X number of activities while you're growing up in your formative years. You have to look and behave in a particular manner. Everybody has to be engineers, has to be doctors. I have so many people that come to my OPD or come to my finishing academy that talk about, our children, if they don't become doctors, then what will they do? So we've had to the extent where we had two twins who were autistic. And the parents said, if they don't become doctors, then what's going to, how will they earn money? So I said, well, this is not going to work. Okay, fine, then we'll have some diagnostic center for them so that they can make some money out of this. Instagram is basically another reflection of everybody having fun, and everybody thinks everybody's having fun while nobody's actually having fun. There's a sense of loneliness. So the self-centric approach that we have today of not just the youngsters, but also at our age, is very evident in our societies, because obviously there's been an influx of anger, there's been an influx of anxiety, there's been an influx of stress. People didn't need people like us earlier. It was the breakup of the joint families, etc. But the younger generation is basically an outcome of what we thought about them, we as parents. So what we think about them, that how good they are, this pressure does not exist elsewhere. It's more with the Asian community, more so with the Chinese and the Indians. We've got the brains of the world, but we don't have social skills. We don't know how to talk, we only know how to talk shop. We don't know how to carry ourselves in social situations, what are the topics that you're not going to talk about, what are the topics that you're going to talk about, how are you going to socialize? And lastly, we have a lot of these marriage failures that are taking place because maybe the bride is redundant and she's always on WhatsApp or whatever it is. But I don't think they have a choice. I don't think they have a choice because they are stuck with it. You said rightly, sir, that they're addicted. But weren't we addicted to television at some point?
I would imagine the addiction was, I mean, used were lower. Today there are so many addictions.
There are so many addictions.
So you tend to get addicted to something or the other quickly.
Yeah, and before I hand this over to somebody else, so as a psychologist, chemical imbalances happen in the brain because certain functions are not happening personally interacting with people. Things like, people are no longer wanting to interact with actual people and have so many friend requests and they don't actually exist.
To my understanding,
that's the way we understand, and that is one. And the other also is the fact that it is a tool. It's up to us how to use it, So if we can manage it, it's great, So, I would say, the kind of impact social media has on our life will probably lead to a better future for the coming generation, whether it's in terms of education, or I would say in terms of increased access to various resources, or even the technological possibilities which are there. So, what we need to understand and navigate is how best to use the tool. In fact, Professor Jain's example, I have a grandson who's 4 years. And it is amazing when I went for his admission, the other children And everybody was talking of planets and other, you know, knowledge which probably I could never visualize that a child so small would know. So the access is there. And how we have, you know, ensured that you ensure that, okay, there is a time management or there is some other management wherein, you know, you get it across in a very right way. So that is one aspect which I would like to emphasize. The discussion, you know, when you read about impact of social media, there's this whole question of, is it all doom and gloom? So it's not all doom and gloom. There is a positive side to it. And I would say in this completely digitally connected world, you need to understand how to use the services better. In fact, here again, you know, I was reminded of this Airbnb. You know, at a time, they were completely not successful, and these two partners, and they were sitting in their own office, they wouldn't know what to do. Then they realized how to use the social media. So they went to actually the locations, you know, where the various houses were, clicked pictures, put it on social media, etc., etc., and look at where the company is. So I think it's all about how to navigate, how to use, and take it forward. So, also it's an important media for a cause, which we have observed in the last 1 year. So if it is a cause and we want to take it forward, I think social media would be really important.
Thank you. Just to make the discussion even interesting, but I'm going to cite some data as well. I think one part of the debate is very age-old. When Gutenberg had the printing press, it was called Gutenberg Galaxy. Then Castells in 2001 said, this is the internet galaxy, obviously. So I won't digress to internet, but let's look at some fresh data as to what happens. This is a fraught question. There is, of course, one side to the story, where there are a whole lot of negative questions which are happening. But there is also of the other side, where people feel that they have freedom of expression. For instance, they do not have to go through formal publishing channels to have people have a look at their blogs. So this is a freedom of expression, and speech is power, or writing is power. It's writing truth to power. So that's a very important aspect of it. And I was looking at some studies, a few studies, and then there is a 2017 study done by University of Petroleum and Wellington University of Victoria. And to me, as an educator, what matters is social media is a form of collective learning, which is happening. Now, how that collective learning is impacting, for instance, the choices people make in life and their education or their effectiveness in education. This is what a predominant concern that I had. So in a survey done from students, and when we use the word generation, I'd like us to be a bit careful because this is a socio-anthropological construct. And the word generation is not just characterized by age group. It is also characterized by certain indicators, like we are the book generation. Therefore, there is no denying that we are looking at the digital natives or the digital generation. Nobody characterized us as the digital generation. So there's nothing, these indicators are not false. And these indicators are here to stay. So with that reality, if we proceed, when students were asked that how many of you are using social media for educational purposes? 20%. Voicing opinion, 33%. Staying informed, 25%. Now this, the other indicator is worrying for me. Job opportunities is 8%. And interacting with friends is 14%. So 14%, if you want a larger world group of interactive group, it's a small number. Job opportunities, 8%. Staying informed is 25%. But voicing opinion is the highest. This is a study done in India. But there is another study, Pew study, done in North America, where these digital natives and some digital immigrants, like us, were asked that how are you different from your, how do you find yourself distinct from other generations? The number is very interesting. 61% said that we are different. Now, why it is interesting? I would imagine 80% of them would say we are different.
So in fact, when 61% I have a number, that tells me, if I interpret the data, that not that many people think that they are very greatly different from the previous generation. This ought to give us some food for thought. So I just want others to jump in and talk about what they think about this at the moment.
From a bit different perspective. Because actually we are talking about impact of social media. Actually media. Social media is the current media. So impact of media and on values actually. It's on values. We are mostly probably talking on behavior, and though behavior and values are related, but we are talking impact on values and future generations. Always there is a future generation. My father also had a future generation, I had a future generation. My grandson will also have a future generation. So actually relation is the current media and the generation. So current media is the dominant media, is the social media, and generation is generation Z, or task in generation, whoever they call, is the generation. And but then we are talking about values. Now values are basically a lot more deep. And we are just, it's a message has come to my WhatsApp, it's very interesting, I hope you don't mind. Is that a guy gets out of the lift on 7th floor instead of 9th floor. He says, I was so busy checking messages on my WhatsApp, without realizing I went to the neighbor's house and sat on their sofa. The lady of the house was glued to the TV, watching serials. She gave me tea without looking at me. When I started drinking tea, I looked up and saw, somebody sent a message, and saw, I remember, the husband of the lady is entering the house. As usual, he was also glued to his WhatsApp. He suddenly saw me and said, I'm sorry, and left the room. So I guess that describes what's actually happening. It's happening, our behavior is changing. I don't know the value. And regarding value, I just heard one talk by some gentleman, I forget, on YouTube. He was talking about working with Kazakhs and the Silas Mistry issue. And I hope he's right. He said, do we know why Ratan Tata, the chairman, who took so much pain throwing out Silas Mistry, so subtly, and so yeah, after 4 years, has he done anything so criminal? Has he missed any business opportunity? And so many things he said. He said, why business? Why he has not done anything? But what has he done? Tata had a contract with Docomo, and the contract has an exit route or something. Now, Tata agreed to give some money to this Docomo if they want to exit. I don't remember exactly total of it. But under the current situation, Mistry took the opportunity of not paying it. And it was not known to Tata. So he was cutting down some unprofitable business areas. People are getting sacked. And particularly, Japanese are very value-based people. Earlier, they used to have business, 1,000 crores on bonds. So when this came to Tata, he was annoyed very much. And he threw out this man, and this man gave dates of everything. The day he threw out this man, just few days later, the case was settled, and Tata paid the money. So, I mean, it is a question of value and integrity, it's very clear. So, I don't know, he's a new generation, he's an older generation. Tata. So question is, these are all, I mean, to be frank, I also teach through WhatsApp group and box very well. So point will remain that media will have an effect, obviously. Whatever media it is, always affect people. And how we use it, how we control it, but how much it will affect the values is a big question, because values are basically more deep-rooted, culturally determined, and lot family-based. But things are changing. There are all points, as you say, sir. And everything has a right to end point. But of course, this needs to be controlled, in my opinion.
So this generation has other such available things available. So that's point number one I want to make. Number two is, why are we simply looking at the future generation? Why won't we look at the current generation itself, which has been? So there are two things about it. Media is a tool or an instrument. And what is a surgeon without his scalpel as an instrument? What is a photographer without his camera? And both of them can be used or misused. So number two. So I think this lament is something which has to be toned down, and we have already gone through the fact that it cuts both ways. You see, so there are issues in terms of, as Professor Gupta pointed out, that there are issues in terms of, we don't have values, sense of right, wrong, good, bad, important, unimportant. Will keep on changing. The world is not static, will keep on changing, and your values will come up. Now the point is that in spite of knowing what is right, wrong, good, bad, or important, unimportant, to what extent our own generation has really followed them? So why are we blaming the future generation? Yes, there is a greatest influence. We used to hide ourselves in the books, and we put a novel within a book and read it, and that used to be a big no-no. If the children are doing this similar kind of a stuff, where is really the issue? So my point is very simple. As the gun lobby in the US says, that it's not the guns which kill people, it's the people who are holding the gun that is, they are responsible. So I would not like to blame the social media. I would say people who are creating the content on the social media are majorly responsible. So if someone starts liking a particular guitarist or a singer, and everyone starts following, of course the attention span and the patience to be really be able to develop their own thought is may not be there, but it has not been there with us also. We are also greatly influenced by it. So when we are debating this, I suppose there is somewhere we need to look at more deeply as to what it is. Yesterday we were trying to catch up with the Joneses, okay? And the Joneses used to be in neighborhood. Thanks to the media, our neighborhood had expanded. Okay, and we want to catch up with everyone else. Of course, again, it cuts both ways. So somewhere or the other, my conclusion would be, it's not the media, it is people who are creating that content on the media responsible. So fake news and other kinds of propaganda that takes place. Somewhere or the other, we need to work out methods so that the content that is put on the media is of a level which does not harm, but it adds on to our own growth as a humanity. That's the only way we can really ensure that the future generation or the current generation, I mean, I don't want to mention it, but how many times the MLAs and the others have been found using the mobile phones and visiting certain sites which no one would like to talk about, actually. So these are labels that we have put up, and somewhere or the other, it has great advantage. Idea is, we need to have mechanisms where we can control or manage the one. Thank you very much for
Thank you very much. Of course, Ashish, please.
And I have to be telling you that this is, I learned a lot. It's amazing. As much as social media, I think it's a very important topic. I don't know, but I'll give two perspectives, because I shuttle between both India and US. I don't know if you're aware, but in US there is now a ICD classification of a disease that if you are actually watching continuously more than 6 hours and you are on a video game or you are watching any kind of, or you are on any kind of social media, that's called mental health. Okay. Now, I'm not going to tell whether it is right or wrong. That's not my goal, but I'm just trying to inform what I'm doing. There are three things which I will just mention. We talked about the negative side, we talked about the positive side, we also say that, very correctly mentioned, that it might be the content. Each one of them has been a great perspective. If I put this way, I look at this, there are opportunities and then there are challenges. The problem is that social media was created for a purpose to connect the disconnect. That was the goal. You can put it in any way, knowledge, sharing, or anything. The problem is that the negativity has come out very big. The the positivity has been somewhat isolated. One of the Pew Research reports says that 87% of older US adults use and interact on social media to make informed decisions. Okay, that's very bad. Now, one of the ways in the Indian context, especially coming from higher ed myself and so many learned people sitting here, one of the things is I would encourage if we can do, and one of the takeaway from this probably could be that each one of you are heading some kind of an institute. So we can actually conduct a multiple geographical way of doing a social media research of what would motivate students to basically go on a positive side of social media. This is a research question. And I can tell you there's no answer right now, because what you quoted on PCS was telling the, what the problems are. But nobody is looking at the solution side of it. So one of the opportunities in this area is interventions. The second becomes is community of learners, because that's an important component, that there is a community of learners which can be done. I know I'm in a, we are among management people, so I talk about market innovations. There are a lot of market innovations. I'll give one example of what we are doing in urban slums in Delhi. We are using WhatsApp to create personalized dietary decision support system for people based on their income. We have about 400 people in the urban slums because they have WhatsApp free. That's a positive side of it. Negative side, I will say that there was a testimony by Mark Zuckerberg in the US Congress. The data was from the countries, but the testimony was being done in the US. So one of the biggest challenge, what you mentioned and Professor Jain mentioned, is cyberbullying. I think, forget about the future generation, that is an immediate thing which needs to be solved now. Cyberbullying is going to be the major threat. The second point is privacy. Who owns the data? So there has to be some kind of a privacy regulation. I'm not saying who comes, what comes, but this kind of a forum is very good platform to actually build research topics among students to do research on these various social media topical areas. The last thing which I will say is, which I would not have said earlier, you mentioned theory of cultural lag and SADM, which is a big bit. Authentication, as Professor Das just mentioned in the right in our early conversation, authentication. We call this term as information therapy. There's actually a term that how can you authenticate the information which is reliable over the internet. This comes under consumer health information. And one of the things which we should do is, I would suggest, and I am more than happy to work with each one of you, is to create Center for Social Media Research. We should not use the word just social media. There's no research going on social media. Honestly. So if we can establish that research aspect in social media, I think if I'm not wrong, I don't know how big are the institutes. If we collectively just take away this, we can come up with one research area and everybody can then do that survey across these institutes. And we can come up with actually a social media policy research government. That's where collective wisdom can come. Thank you very much.
That's a very, very useful point. While talking of cyberbullying and those kinds of social issues, which is essentially the school perspective, teenagers' perspective. But then you have to extend that argument to a higher level. It's called the user's vulnerability to crime. See, because of the social media and the internet, you have a lot of information that gets shared, and Facebook has had all that story that you have heard. People post this story that came up, the guys with the mask broke into the house and want to steal everything. And the one of the guys says, where is your that set of jewelry? She says, like, you know, I don't have that jewelry. No, you have that jewelry because you
posted
it. I'm your Facebook friend, you know, we are your Facebook friend. So the crimes can hit people because of the information which is being flowed. Now the way I see it, it's an evolution of society. We had information 2000 years ago, set of information, or maybe earlier. we have information now. The quantum of information has changed from 1 BC to 5000 BC or whatever to 2018, any quantum information. The human behavior is based on the set of information that you have and what is relevant to you and what you desire to do, you conduct yourself accordingly. So wherever we talk of good things, it's perfect. We should leverage it. Wherever there is a negative thing, the way I say it, you have to fall back on human behavior. You know, psychologists should come in. It's like saying, Hindi mein jo sher hai, main bol nahi paunga. Vices are many in this society. You need to know what you should stay away from. I'll give you a very, not a good example. When I got admission into IIT Delhi, this was way back in 1974, my father told me that IIT Delhi, among all IITs, is the worst IIT on drug abuse. Okay? But since I had my schooling in Delhi, so I wanted to be in Delhi, you know, I like place Delhi, state capital, you know, you want to be there. So I said, I want to go to Delhi. He says, okay, you go to Delhi, that's fine, but you be aware, right? This is a vice which can finish you off, right? Stay away from it. And he taught me a thing which I tell to my kids and everyone. He said that say no the first time and every time. And I stuck to it. So, and then when you get into the campus, then you know, I'm looking around, keep on here, who's the guy, who's the guy. And I would actually ask questions. So somebody actually said, haan chahiye kya? So, I don't know, I'm curious to know how do these guys look like. You know, I'm curious, So the vices are many, and if there are vices coming in the society because of the social media, we need to be aware ourselves, we need to be making others aware of this, particularly any vulnerable generation, and kind of teach them that you should be, you know, doing these kinds of things and not doing these kinds of things, and stay away from it, and that's how you should conduct. As far as you know, one story came of bullying time where, you know, I like to be seen in this particular group. Like if I want to be known as a guitar player, so the fake news can be spread about guitar playing and all. Now in the real world, when we school kids, we have had friends who would claim to be a guitar player, right? There's no guitar around. But he says, main guitar baja le aata hu, you know, I play guitar. Oh, he's okay, wonderful, very good, nice guy and all that. Maybe some girls like the boys, kisko guitar aata hai, you know, all that kind of things will happen. It used to happen. And when there is a, you know, once in a blue moon there will be guitar somewhere. You know, we'll say there are other good players of guitar. Then you ask this guy to be playing and they'll find some excuse to go away. Right? He'll go away. But until that moment, he has taken the advantage of projecting himself as a guitar player. This happened then. This will happen now. Because of the quantum of information and the speed of flow of information, the dynamics have changed. So we need to be kind of aware of this and look into how do we handle this. We have another 40 minutes to go, enough time. But the way I wanted to look at this entire issue is to classify this entire thing into five groups. And under those five groups, look at what all are relevant to us and what are all not relevant to us. We have assorted perspectives in the media and the newspapers. Sometimes I read this economist from UK, wonderful articles they have on, you know, any contemporary issue, including on social media. So these five groups that I would like to look into is, you know, put the social media impact on psychological perspective, put social media impact on social perspective, put this impact on political perspective, put this impact on education perspective, and put this impact on official or big business perspective. These are five things. So, like official business, you know, very useful. You know, if you are looking only for that perspective, wonderful thing to have. The speed of, you know, we used to say almost 20 years back, this is when we were in Montreal for the first time in Canada. There you see these flyovers and massive flyovers everywhere and the traffic zoom, zoom, zoom. So we used to tell, you know, I told my friend, look at the speed of the traffic. The higher the speed of the traffic, that reflects the economy of the country. In India, this is 1990, around 90s, early 90s. In India, the average traffic speed was 40 kilometers on the highways, 50 on the highway. वैसे तो इंडिया का 50 किलोमीटर हाईवे का स्पीड है, इधर का हाईवे का स्पीड है 125 किलोमीटर पर आवर. So that gives you a reflection of the state of economy, and I think rightly so. Our average speed on the highways have gone up, so it has linked to the GDP growth rate in our country. Yeah. So similarly, the information highway, the speed of flow of information in the early 90s was at a certain level. The speed of information today is at a certain different level. So how does this impact? So information flow has a business meaning. Now imagine in you know, when a business situation, in a matter of minutes, you literally close the deal, because in those few minutes, 100 email exchanges have happened across a set of people and deal is closed. Same situation 20 years back, it would have taken about a month to close the matter, maybe phone call and things like that. So the economy is to grow faster. Now the downside is that when we have the information on a personal level, how does it impact? When we have information on the political level, how does it impact? The classic example of Russian interfering in the US elections. And in India, Cambridge Analytica being tainted, while the tainting happened in the US because of the US elections, but it got linked to India also that they are doing this. Now, one of the important aspects of, when you read that article on the role of, how did the Russians influence the elections in the US? You know, when you read that in the newspapers, I was kind of thinking, like, what would they do? How can the Russians influence the US elections? I was looking for information on this, you know, all the time. And luckily, I found one article. And I read there the Cambridge Analytica story. The entire story of Cambridge Analytica was there as to how it came up and how it got into the Facebook thing. So I'll not go into that story. But the gist of this is that once you have the information on the individuals, I know what you like, why you know what you don't like, you know, and I can influence you by the set of information that you like. So it is like you have in the population vegetarians and you have non-vegetarians. Right? And there are a few people who say, I'm okay, that's fine, you know, I can be anywhere. Now, if someone wants to convert this population into something more radical, so this guy starts sending out messages to the vegetarians. Right? Vegetarian is this way. And then these guys become vegans. You know vegans? Yeah. Extreme vegetarians. Mm-hmm. The milk is an animal product. Right? So they become vegans. So the extreme happens because of the information. So I'm told that, you know, you are a vegetarian, that's a great thing, but you know, you're not a true vegetarian. Are you a true vegetarian? So I get bombarded with those messages and I become a vegan. I said, no, milk I cannot take, for example. So likewise, in a political scenario, what happened in the US, essentially only through the social media, they said we have this population of Democrats and the Republicans. So if you were to split the population and you plot the graph, that 10% is pure Republican and 10% is pure Democrats. 80% are overlapping, right? They may have a bent of mind, the fence sitters. So category A, category B, which is extreme, and category F with the fence sitters. Right? Now because of the information available, you want to influence those fence sitters. So I start tracking you. Right? Who is your role model? Who is this? So your role model is, let's say, Amitabh Bachchan. So I'll ensure that you get fake news, Amitabh Bachchan saying that by doing this, you become a better person. Your role model is Amitabh Bachchan, and I use that prop to communicate those messages to you at the infinitum, and after a certain point of time, from being F category, you become A category, or from F category, you become a B category. And all the information that has been sent out to you are fake, I mean majority of them. This is what was alleged on the Cambridge Analytica case in the US election. So they converted these fence sitters into the Republicans' helping Trump win the elections. And the Democrat, the Hillary team, was actually not aware of this. So they were caught, by the time they realized, the results were declared. So, you know, I mean, this is how it is. So how do you handle this from, your own conduct and, growth of your own self in whatever domain or perspective? These things will keep happening and they will be there. Vices are a galore. Everywhere the vices are there. You need to figure it out how to control them.
And they confess their patience level has come down. their attention span has come down, their reading habits has come down. I'm not saying social media is bad, definitely good, but this is something that is a concern. They are not reading enough, they are not being attentive, they are not being patient, they are not being compassionate, you know, because it's all self-centered and continuously trying to be better than the Jones. So that's, at the practical level, a serious concern.
Yeah, absolutely. See, it's like the information.
What we didn't tell the consumers was the radical behavioral changes this kind of market innovation is going to bring. So ethics in social media, whether in content or whether in promoting business, is something, it's a late starter but definitely happening. Google and Facebook were gods earlier who couldn't be touched, but right now I think they have been brought down from the pedestal. So that's a beginning, and this has to be done in a far more organized manner, as the Dr. Das just pointed out, that we should have these issues formalized, like what does politics, what does psychology of social media mean? Similarly, ethics in social media, it is high time to get a lot of research done.
Few things from the older days, then I learned a story from Panchatan. And this is a story about four wise men who were very learned, four Brahmins, and they have the ability to put life into a dead animal or something like that. And when they were passing through, they saw the bones are spread all around, and then one man said, I can feel that these are the bones of a lion. And he assembled the bones and he showed that basically it's a lion. Second wise man said, I can put like nerves, veins, muscles, etc., the skin on this skeleton. The third one said, I can put life. The fourth one, the younger one, who was basically not a wise man, he said, before you put life, let me climb up a tree. Because I know what is going to happen. So he climbed up a tree and he saved life. Correct. But the point I am making here, the lion in a jungle, social media in modern society is same thing. You can save yourself or you can tame it. It is up to your wisdom whether you would like to save or you remember when Alfred Nobel has invented dynamite, it was also a big invention, but at the same time it is also dangerous. And his own elder brother died in the blast in the factory which he has created. So what happened, that who said that we need social media? Do we need social media before it was invented? It is only few guys who have got entrepreneurial skill to demonstrate their entrepreneurship, they have created social media. So only problem is we are given so many things in life which is probably not required. So we have to make a judicious choice. Do we really need social media? That's it.
Shiv, please. Shiv.
This is first for me. And I just wanted to make a point regarding what sir said. Social media is not a line that you cannot tame, because there are good use of social media. There are a lot of companies which thrive on social media, which have made our life easy. In morning I came by Uzo, which is a media based company, totally on the basis of media. There are a lot of things that you can do. There are a lot of good uses of social media. One of them is what I use in my class. We can access to Harvard lectures, MIT lectures on MIT soft open source. So there are good uses of social media which outweigh the harmful effects of the bad uses of social media. So my personal view is that, you know, the good use of social media outweighs the bad use of social media. Now the question is, how do we control the bad use of social media? One way is what the government does. They, you know, ban the internet outrightly. So I don't think that is an appropriate way, because this causes a lot of inconvenience. But then better compliance, or probably, you know, as far as media is concerned, you know, everything can be tracked, if I'm not wrong. Everything can be monitored, everything can be controlled. So I think it's like you should have a better compliance and better monitoring. That's the only solution that I can come up with. And last thing is, if you don't use social media, you are uninformed. If you use too much of social media, then you are misinformed. That's all.
Sir, Rakhi wanted to say something.
Sir, I just wanted to make it great today, or it's harmful today. I think there are two most important things. One is the device, and the other is the connectivity. I mean, the moment it's the same as, you know, news being 20 minutes a day to a 24-hour news channel. It's the same thing. Social media being used on in a cyber cafe for 20 minutes, 200 rupees, as compared to being used in your pocket for 24/7. So then the decision comes is, what is it happening? I mean, it's the availability of the information. The information was always there. Social media, on the contrary, is just the mode which has changed. But it's a beautiful thing in a way, because this is the only platform which is two-way communication. None of the media is two-way communication these days. So it is very important to look at this technology aspect as well, whether which is the connectivity and the devices. That's the only thing I want to say.
Or so to speak, any new technology that comes has the, you know, positive and negative. Nuclear technology came, it has both things, you know, positive and negative. What do you want to harness, you need to figure out.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So this is what
I'm saying.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think it's very clear that social media has created a problem, and it is a problem. And now, I mean, the point which Dr. Jain raised, well, can we get rid of the social media? I don't think so. It is possible now. It is a part of everything. Now the question is, what is the solution? I mean, the problem has been very clear, and then in fact, the last year, somewhere some data, if I recollect, it was published in almost all the leading newspapers. It talks about, the kind of downloads with the youngsters does in India, the kind of mostly the unwanted sites. It was enormous in the sense, like, we are, as in a country and India, it was, we are the number one in terms of downloading all those contents, because we are, high in the kind of youngster population. That gives alarming situations. Because that's what we are, the kind of information which is available. Now the solution is, probably this is what I find. I think this is a lack of awareness. Now we are talking about future generations. Now we cannot control, as a faculty, as an institute, we cannot control the whole future generations in a country. But yes, we have a control, because we are privileged in the sense, like, we have a lot of students, our own students. Now you ask your own students, like, how many of them, if you talk to them about the social media, and first thing they will come about, either it's the Facebook, or probably they will talk about Twitter, or they may be talking about Instagram. And none of them, or very rare, people talk about the LinkedIn. In fact, most of the organization recruits people through LinkedIn. I mean, even the organizations, the organization can even vouch and then can verify your profile and everything. And none of them. It's very, very sad. And if you see that, even if you ask them, they may be having an account, but it might have been not opened for a long time. But without Facebook, without Twitter, or maybe not even Twitter, or Instagram, for that matter, even WhatsApp, not even a single half a day, or maybe in a day, they'll be living without that. Now, let me just share two of the incidents which I was a part of it. Like, the engagement process. Like, how we can, as a faculty, how we can engage the students into the process. And that's what, maybe in a kind of organization, where an institute, where we can talk about how we can integrate it. Where we can integrate the students and making aware of them the benefit of the social media, probably that's one way that we can talk about. So I developed a course on fair trade and social justice. It was a very popular course in Kavli School of Business, Fordham University, part of New York. We had a professor there. I've been working with her closely for more than 7-8 years. It was a course on fair trade and microcredit, as well as fair trade on social justice. So we wanted to integrate the students from both from there to here. The idea was, we selected somewhere around 15 grassroots organizations who are not even popular among, So we used a social media platform, particularly Facebook, to connect, to integrate, and then even we tried to do marketing for those grassroots organizations who are producing the fair trade products, which is very popular in the Western world. So that is where we can engage the students, we can make them to be a part of it. That's one way where probably it can work out. Now, another story is, I had a recently faculty joining my institute. So we had two sons, only 4 years old and 2 years old. And since there are not a lot of gap between the child, so the younger one had a problem, because every time he stays just above my floor, every time, day and night, he keeps on crying. So one day I asked him, what's the problem? So he said he has some kind of mental issues. In the shop, just a 4 years old child. So when I asked what is the issue, because he's trying to put him in a school and everywhere he's getting rejected. And then he's not in a kind of normal situation. He's not in a kind of normal, regular kids. When we asked, the answer was, because the gap between the two children were very less, and then the younger one to take care of him, what he does was, he hands over the mobile to him, with the Facebook or maybe some kind of, the YouTube, mostly the YouTube videos. And this fellow was continuously, he's happy, and then she's also happy because she's taking care of the second child, and the process goes on, and then now, the situation is without the mobile, he cannot do anything. The only time where he sleeps from 10 o'clock to morning, you know, 6 o'clock, whatever, then that is the only time where he is completely. Now, I'm telling you, I really see a kind of hell in life. You know, to manage the kids, he's not getting admission for anywhere, which is terrible. And all we are responsible for that. So it's the parents who are responsible. Most of the time you go and see the child, you know, suppose he's creating problems, you know, either you give him a mobile or, you know, buy a game or, you know, whatever it is. That's the problem. The problem is like it's awareness. Either it's the parents or the teachers, then ultimate solution is, what me personally was, how you can integrate. Social media has a plenty of, you know, opportunities. It's a great opportunity. You cannot. Most of the organization now, the young entrepreneurial organizations are using only social media as a kind of platform for the development. So that's where, you know, kind of probably, if you look into that, where we can connect, where we can integrate the younger generations, so-called what we are talking about, the future generation, probably that is going to take lead for the, better futures.
Wonderful. So we have Ashish is wanting to say thought.
Yeah.
And after this,
I'm going to emphasize this. I'm very, very well funded by the US government. Okay? Very well funded by federally government. They regulate data. I have to tell you, data is the key. It is not just social media. So one of the things is that we should be assuring, like for example, all this WhatsApp, even the interaction what we are having, who is storing this data? So, to be honest, we are actually giving ourselves everything away. The data is not sitting here. And I'm not going to cite because of the confidentiality reasons, just because on a project I'm very well funded on social media spectrum privacy issues in the US. But I will tell you, you cannot take their data in any way. I'm also funded by the government of India. And one of the challenges here is who owns and who stores the data. So the idea of like looking at it, right now you see, we put up an ad, our student data will go everywhere. Everybody will contact everybody. So I think one of the biggest problem which from, I think we are working in urban slums in Delhi, one of the challenges, and this is not a problem just with the student, but you rightly said that the biggest problem is that it's ease. We want our ease. So what we are doing, give us the cell phone to the chat. And do not, he should not disturb or she should not disturb, and I don't want to get disturbed. That is a behavioral addiction. That is one part. Because of ma'am also mentioned, like stress is becoming, it's a big. But I would urge and I would say that, you know, we always say that we have a 70-65% young population in this country. I can tell you it can be both a boon and a curse. And that's a white paper I've submitted. It could be.
Yes.
It is. I don't think that this should be just viewed as a strength. So last thing I would urge is that please, you are among all the leading institutes out over here. I think you should probably make social media research as a privacy, as a fundamental core group, which can drive what higher education needs. I think that would be a very important thing. Very much.
Yes, just to add to, you said some very wonderful points. The world, entire world is now trying to put laws together on what we call the data protection or the privacy laws. US has had this privacy law for long, yet the data was sought. Okay? And what they would do, remove the name and put a number, right? So you still are able to use the privacy. India, we don't have any privacy law yet, but only now what is called the GDPR, you know, General Data Protection Regulation, is getting in place, and then, you know, hopefully things will happen. But then, you know, we need to understand one thing. Whenever there's a new thing coming, there are some ills associated with this, and the society learns as we grow along. Just to give you an example, just to drive the point home, when the first car was manufactured, first car, you know, four wheels and the steering, there was no airbag in that car. And then the people started dying because of the speed started going up, and then the people die. So, you know, the accidents happening. So the system says, okay, we have a problem now. And you don't say that because of this problem, you don't drive the cars. continue to drive the car, but find a solution. So now we have cars with, you know, I don't know how many airbags, 8 airbags, or you drive only the airbags, you know, so that you're completely protected. So those checks and balances and, you know, corrective actions are happening. Similarly with the social media, if we get to know cases where, you know, as a parent, I get to know, you know, that story, you know, they did this also. In my own home, I said, no, don't give mobile phone to the kid, just stay away. Whatever it takes, you know, don't let the kid touch your phone. So then the society starts, you know, shaping up. So you always have to, unless you see the problem, unless you see those issues, the corrective action will not be taken, right? And that's the way the society evolves, the technology evolves. You know, cars had no airbags, and today you see kind of things you have in the cars too. You know, we have this Lamborghini accident here. The car was literally a pulp. The guy who was driving came out, you know, rubbing his shirts and everything, he came out and he ran away because he had killed a few people on the road in Delhi, and the Lamborghini was a complete smash. So that's the technology we're getting. You know, the safety is there. So similarly, in time, I'm sure social media will have those checks and balances. We don't know how it'll be done. See, at that point of time, when cars were being made, I don't think anybody would have figured out that there's would be something called airbag. Right? So I don't know what kind of airbag we will have in the social media to protect ourselves individually and as we grow.
Just one point. The story which you narrated, I know that there is, I think, you know, we also need to reach that little level of
value system. But where do the youngsters get the value system? It's basically coming from us. So what is happening is that parenting has gone for a toss. Because parents, you see, what happens is, like you mentioned about your father, saying that when you're getting into the IIT, a lot of people take drugs. But if you took your father as a role model, you will not pick up the drugs. But if you did not take up your father as a role model, you will look for other role models and get affected by the peer group. So what is happening here is that the value system within the home has not been created by the parents because everybody is very busy. And social media actually takes care of this also, because some of the women sitting at home probably have nothing else to do but be on the social media. You could go to PTMs in school, while their turn is coming to meet the teacher, they're still on, you know, looking for the last minute WhatsApp. So little time, little values are going to be shared with children. Children are not growing up. So as a psychologist, when children walk up and we say, who's your role model? And they have no role models within the home. They don't have grandparents, they don't have fathers, they don't have mothers, they don't have anybody. So obviously they're so vulnerable in their formative years that they're going to get influenced by the outside world. Value system can only be passed on if the parents are having this value system at home, which unfortunately we've lost. We're actually picking up things which the Western culture has discarded, and we're picking up all that here. I'm sure the Indian families living outside India are more retaining their Indian culture with their children. We've unfortunately lost that. So I blame the parents for this. And we see this many times in restaurants and everywhere, just so that a little child keeps quiet, a little iPad is put with cartoons on it so that the parents don't have to really struggle with it. And so we are looking for placebos in every form. And we need to bring in that particular thing. And I think the youngsters feel that anything that is in is should be westernized. But that's not the approach, because it's not happening with the youngsters in other parts of the world. We don't respect our language, and we don't respect a lot of other things. So while we respect Indian food, so Indian food becomes the international cuisine of the world. We don't respect our language, so our language does not even have presence in the United Nations. So what we're talking about is that you need to value whatever you have, because other countries are doing that. In other countries, the youngsters are also very sportive. They are actively involved in sports, whereas our people are generally in gyms. And that too, I don't know if everybody is. So the value system needs to be followed, culture needs to be looked into. And we need to adapt this in our everyday life. And that has got nothing to do with the social media, because we will discard whatever's not good in the social media, because automatically it's not acceptable. And we will accept whatever is acceptable. This is what I feel.
I perfectly agree with you. I think there is negative. You know, as an individual, because it essentially comes down to individual. Any other activity is a group activity or discipline. So in an individual level, we need to understand that we need to discipline ourselves. Now, I can give you my own example. You know, WhatsApp we are all on, email we are all on. Sometimes our faculty don't get my email response. I said, well, I'm not sitting on my screen or on my phone 24/7 waiting for a mail to be sent by you, right? So I have my own schedule. If there is anything urgent, you give me a call, you come to my office or you know, whatever. Don't wait for an email response. You know, you send an email and then you say, yeah, no responses come. No, I don't operate like that. Email is asynchronous communication. So you send a mail, I will send my mail as per my convenience. So you have to have a discipline. So we need to kind of, you know, tell any user, be it a new generation or what you call millennials kids, yeah, you know, now the younger millennial, which is between 20 to 25 years of age, and older millennials, which is 25 to 40 years old. The millennials are 40 years to 20 years age. So we need to, essentially, the way I said, to discipline it. Like, for example, WhatsApp. In 24 hours time, my WhatsApp time is fixed. Right? That's more or less, plus minus 5% is fixed. If there are too many messages, too much of videos, you know, I would just skip it. I said, forget it. You know, my life doesn't depend on watching that gyan which is being shared by someone on the WhatsApp. I don't care. If I have to have the urge to respond, I have time, I'll respond. But there are times where I would just not check the WhatsApp message. That's it. And I don't feel bad about it. And similarly on the email. Emails, you know, the way Google operates, they don't put things on spam. You know, they have their own algorithm, you know, they put a junk mail. Someone who is spamming you continue to you know, get the mail from the inbox, and it is very difficult to declare a mail as a, you know, a spam mail. While it was easy in Zimbra and other things. So you get mail. So you know what you do? I mean, I receive about close to 100 emails a day on my own personal email ID. So you look at the subject line, who the sender, and like check, delete, right? And then I respond to our own thing. So you have to have a discipline. And also, you know, as I said, the vices, you know, the vices or whatever. So you should be aware of the vices and then the discipline yourself. How do you handle this? And I think that's the only way. Government and the regulatory agencies may come up with a GDPR, General Data Protection Laws, but then, you know, we have laws for so many things in the regular world, the crimes do happen, and all those things do happen. So you need to be aware of it, you need to understand yourself, what you're doing, and then hopefully take care of yourself. Right? So this is what I would like to, you know, look at it from this perspective. But then you must understand the ills, why this ills happen, and on things which are not at the personal level, which is at the aggregate level, like the US election interference by Russian agencies. That's not at an individual level. So maybe those agencies need to figure out how do we handle those situations, that those kind of interferences are not being done in an unethical or unauthorized way to influence decisions or minds of the people, which is harmful to them in the long run. Right? So we need to kind of take a cue on this. Maybe we can have some feedback response from students. Yeah. Name yourself and then I'll say my email.
Good evening. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ankur Gupta from FORE School of Management. First of all, on behalf of all the students present, adapted to the use of internet and social media, whereas the generations born in the late 90s or the 21st century are born with the internet-based app, as Dr. Jitendra rightly said in the beginning. And one important fact for our elders would be like they are connecting with their children who are not living with them based on the social media app. And also it is very important for us to differentiate between the positives and the negative aspects. So today's discussion would help us in more taking a more educated decision on things based on social media. Few of the questions that like the students have are...
To aware our colleagues or our younger siblings about the proper use of the social media, the practical approach I wanted to ask you about.
So
So anyone?
You should to us.
So, guys, everybody's concluding here actually that everything begins at home. We need to discipline ourselves.
Sir.
I have to be very honest with you, right? I have two kids, 4 and 10. And I'm, please do not take it in any way, okay? This is not a comment. But I will be honest with you. There is much more discipline there than me. Please, this is not in any way, okay? This notion that this is, I won't call this as a Western word because I've done my PhD part in Brazil. Brazil's demographics were very similar to India. It is the only country which has very similar demographics. It has a very large young population. But there's the biggest interest in Brazil. If you go there, everybody wants to become American. Okay? So what they did, they got distracted from all their own values, what ma'am just mentioned. Right? And so one of the ways is, how do we really inculcate at home? If you are, and this is a great example, if you can fix your WhatsApp, trust me, the kid is not going to find a role model out. They are going to find it in. In my scenario or my wife's scenario, yeah, we used to watch WhatsApp out, but certain things you change over a period of time. So one of the things is self-discipline, that is one. Second thing, I think child will go to school, right? Ma'am said that there is an awareness about question, about screen time.
Yes.
Now, I can't comment here because of ignorance. At least I live in New Jersey. Schools, the kids are not allowed to bring phones to the school. So, yeah, that's why I said I don't know that much. The kids are allowed in high school. They cannot turn on the phone during the school time. There's certain rules and regulations on that. The third, you have to watch what the kid is watching. A lot of times we don't watch what they're watching. So these are some, just I can tell you from my own personal as well as that. But educational institutes do have responsibility, to be honest. This social media should become an integral course. Integral. And ma'am, you have chosen the very right word, ethics. So if we can incorporate those things, self-discipline, able to view very clearly, I don't know, like there are, like, for example, like my daughter has a school computer. She gets a computer in grade 3. But the state can watch everything what she does on the computer. Everything. So they can't just go to any site. So what they're doing is, yes, we want you to get connected, but we want you to get regulated. I'm not aware whether what the notion here is, but I think apart from the role of information technology ministry, I think it is also the responsibility of human resource, HRD ministry, or education. You don't want to deprive people for not able to connect, as you just mentioned that they are always missing out. But at the same time, you also have to have certain regulations, you know. With no regulations, it's not going to work. You can do it. And I'm going to echo with Professor Gandhi's concern. It is very alarming. I've been coming here for 8 years in India. And I'm telling you this right now. This is very, very alarming situation because of my own sister kids I see them. It is a question of convenience. Sorry about that, but it's a very good question what you have.
Of communication, that's all. And then you figure out, you know, any vehicle can be used anyway. So you need to figure out. So if you get a bicycle, for example, and you are riding on the bicycle all the time, you come into this meeting all riding on the bicycle, then there are problems. So likewise, you sit here, you're not supposed to use any social media thing, and using social media, you have a problem. So now, scientifically, organizations have defined that if you are on the social media for more than so many hours a day, like typically the average figure in December 2017 in US was 3.7 hours per day and Hong Kong was 4.8 hours per day. Chinese are kind of more into this. So people say if it is around this, then we are addicted. Now, addiction, the way I define is if you have an urge to do something and if you are denied that, then you become restless. So that's my way of defining. I'm not a psychologist, but that's how I treat as addiction. So therefore, I define it like that. So I say, okay, I cannot be addicted to anything. So addiction here, in my view, is not linked to the time of usage. If I discipline myself to use it for 3 hours in the morning and 3 hours in the evening, that's it. And if I cannot finish, that's okay. I don't have the urge beyond this time to look for messages. This time has very little to do with addiction because I studied 14 hours a day for many years, never got addicted to this. So, addiction has nothing to do with time. You get addicted to studying all the time? No. Time has got nothing to do with this. It's the urge to do something and you are prevented from that, then you have a restlessness. Right? Then that's how I define addiction. So we need to understand from that point of view and enforce the discipline. Forced to leave the presidency was Ukraine in 2013. Okay? Because of the public outcry, reportedly 100,000 people assemble quietly in a park, Central Park. And all, no noise, no, just they assemble that, we need to change our president. And, a few days later he had to resign. We know the Brexit.
Yes.
People say Brexit, the social media played a great role. We are aware of the US elections. We are aware of what's happening in India. So type A, type B and type F. So if you're pro this government or pro that government, and in between, now because of the social media, there are professionals working in India proactively because of the 2019 election to shift the people towards this side or that side. The both the parties now, because it's known, the US election, maybe this was the first time Cambridge Analytica did it, but now it's known, so both the parties are now trying to do the same to each other. So therefore some balancing effect will happen. But we need to understand this, and we would be the recipient of these messages. So we need to really figure out what is good for us and not good for us. Oh yeah, of course. This was the first one. Ukraine guy going for the first time. Arab Spring and all that. Germany, there was a political party in Germany, the extreme right-wing political party.
Right.
And as per some report, they said that only 1% population would support it. They did a campaign and they got 12.5% votes in the last election. And you know what was the campaign? It was all fake. Campaign was the Syrian refugees will get better doses or amenities than the native Germans. It was all fake news. So because of this fake thing coming in, a lot of people shifted and they voted. So, the political party was not supposed to win the election, may win because of the fake news and campaign that is happening. So we need to be aware of these ills of the society that may impact us, not in the short run, but in the long run. If an undeserving political party comes in, they change our life for a long duration. So we need to be aware of this. Now we are 6 minutes out of 1 o'clock. Anybody would like to summarize what we discussed today?
First thing, just a small proposal.
Summary, please.
It's not summary, rather the future, maybe the action we can take. We are sitting like some of the directors heading a business school, and then I think either monthly basis or quarterly basis, can we create a forum maybe within this umbrella of FWA, that if we can meet regularly and such talk can be watched by our faculty member or student, audience can also be there, and at least good thing is that we can create awareness. And somebody was asking that what to do. I think there is something called self-fulfilling prophecy. If I will say social media is a double-edged sword, social media has vices, etc., then all of a sudden you are reminded that I should be very aware, I should be very aware. In fact, today I am feeling that I should get out from Facebook, and I am going to do that today. I have got maybe 5,000 friends, but I am going to write, this is my phone number, this is my email,
And that's good enough if you want to remain in touch with
me. Yes.
And today, self-discipline is important.
I agree with you 100%.
And today I'm going to do that.
Yes. Self-discipline is important. This is almost, I think, 2000. I joined Facebook in 2006 when the Facebook had just come. I'm enrolled there. I was reasonably active. And in 2012 or 13, I posted a video clip of a family member. And I thought, this is before the messenger thing, you know, I thought this is meant for only those people because I did those selections and everything. And I was not very sure, you know. So then I created a fake account, the account of myself, you know, some XYZ kind of thing. And from there, I wanted to watch myself, right? And I could see all that video. I am not a friend of me. And then I could see everything. I said, like, what is this? And that's the last time I was on Facebook. I continue to have a Facebook account, zero activity since, as in, no, this is not the way. And then later the messenger came because some of my friends said, yeah, tu kuch nahi kar raha. Maine kaha nahi, they said, no, you do it on messenger. I said, I have WhatsApp for that, right? So you need to understand this and maintain some kind of a discipline and then you are good to go. So any quick recap view on this? If nobody gives, I'll give you my perspective as a summary point. Essentially what we say is that good things are good, bad thing we need to be aware of, and the core, the way we kind of look at is the discipline. We need to be informed, we need to be aware, be vigilant, and then maintain self-discipline and do it at the individual level. At the larger society level, then we hope, we expect the regulators, the government, to take appropriate action to curtail these kinds of things, enact laws, protect the privacy of people. But for us at the immediate action level, we need to be more vigilant, aware, and maintain the define your own discipline norms. And in the process, and then wherever there is a bad story, you share it. So once I know a family having that kind of issue, that's how the society evolves. So everybody will become cautious of this. And maybe we are good to handle the social media for ourselves. Right?
And so we all depended upon forwarded
because of the eyeballs getting in. This is what is called alternate revenue model. So I give you something free, but I still make my money.
Yeah.
So because of those things happening, you know, regulators cannot say you charge money. Then you know, it will not happen because you can always give anything free. Not in this time, in some other form, I can give it free.
The company is already printing money.
Yeah. So you can't do that. But we need to understand that.
Sir, in educational institutions, what we can do, and you already need that. It would be high, it could be very low. From my data,
I would include this. I would suggest that one last thing you should do is.
Max two minutes now. We need to close.
Okay, I'll add one last thing. It would be great if people can set up, as we mentioned, a social media. For example, we are working on a road traffic engineering data for the government of India. Okay? It is in collecting in 5 states. The first question the government asks, where is the data getting stored? Okay, you already allowed Amazon Cloud. You're already sending your data outside. So one thing which we can do is, I think if some of the people institutes are interested, that we should establish some kind of a research project in this domain. Because to be honest, without data, assumptions can be great, but data can speak a lot.
That means research will be
right. They are finding challenge on writing data governance laws. That is it. And last thing I will say, when you open a Facebook, or I'm not on Facebook at all.
Me neither.
Okay, so, and I'm glad that you have decided, because that's, I think, good accomplishment of this forum today. I will say that even if you delete your account, they will retain your information. Nobody knew it until this testing unit became public with Mark Zuckerberg in the US Senate.
See, normally you say, I agree.
Young generation should be exceptionally careful for the 2019 elections. You will find social media. Forget it is happening within the country. I'm going to be very honest.
Yeah.
It is going to happen
Cambridge Analytica in targeting with the specific messages, because there's a child's play now, literally. No, it's being done. So you be aware of
awareness and self-regulation.
So I think we need to close here. And thank you very much for bearing with the moderator.
Thank you for your
time to do this. Now, Professor Gandhi would like to.
Okay. I, on behalf of FWA and also on behalf of his permission, FORE School, extend to you thanks. For your visit here, for your presence here. Once again, you have spared very precious time for this occasion. And special, fitting moments outside. And that time, it was also raining when you must have started. And you made it a point that you are reaching here. Again, it is a good sign of your gesture. Once again, we extend our thanks to all of you and hope that you people will be meeting again and again on these forums. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Please.